table, got so many plays on it. Number two from CrossFit Fort Vancouver, Reagan Huckabee.
The lights are on, and for the first time ever, the action for the individuals will carry on in the Coliseum setting of the Alliant Energy Center in Madison, Wisconsin. It's time for event number three in the women's side of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Amanda Krenz with you. And we haven't seen this environment yet, and it is going to be electric in this building throughout the weekend. The first test we see here is something with a lot of meaning in the community. Amanda, 45, it's a new spin on it.
Oh, look, the barbells are back. That's fantastic. We get some squat snatches and ring muscle-ups. We're anting up. We're going, instead of 21 total reps, we're going to 45 total reps of muscle-ups and squat snatches. This is a heck of a way to start the individuals off in the Coliseum.
And there's plenty of meaning to this event in games history. For more on that, we go to Amanda Krenz.
This is a tribute workout named after Amanda Miller. She competed in the 2009 CrossFit Games. Less than a year after that, she passed away. In 2010, CrossFit Games director Dave Castro dedicated the first event to Amanda Miller. It was called Amanda. It was snatches and muscle-ups. That's what we're about to see here. There are going to be some athletes on the floor who competed in 2009 with Amanda Miller, including Stacy Tovar, Annie Thorsdottir. Ben Smith was there too. And now once again, these games athletes get a chance to pay tribute to a past competitor, Amanda Miller.
Thank you, Amanda. And the first heat of athletes to take on this event include a field of eight, and I say eight because in lane number eight, Chelsea Hughes has withdrawn from the competition. She's one of two athletes to do so on this side. We'll talk more about that in a bit. Margo Alvarez also in this heat, and that's a bit of a surprise. And for the very first time, the individuals are in action on the Coliseum floor here in Madison, Wisconsin, starting with a round of 13 muscle-ups.
And see, think about traditional Amanda, that actually has turned into, you know, back in 2010, it was quite the event when it was first announced. And I think one of the hardest part that people don't remember is that it's the first time they've raised the rings so high that athletes couldn't get a false grip. So non-false grip, which your traditional muscle up you see. Well, it's gotten so crazy, it's been unbroken touch and go reps. Here, you gotta break the sets up early, especially on the rings, because though 13 isn't a lot, when you go down to 11, 9, 7, 5, it definitely adds up when you add in the squat snatches. Now, squat snatches, you still have that upper body pull, even though it's from the floor. Use the legs when you lift. So when your guys are snatching out there, the old stand, jump, and catch is what you're looking for. Efficiency is key when it comes to this movement.
Leader's name on the top of the screen will be highlighted in blue. That currently is Alethea Boone, who we saw in lane number one out in front. And this is curious with Carlene Matthews still standing on the start mat. Not sure what is happening here. We'll try to get word and we'll get that to you as soon as we can, but definitely not something good here for Carlene Matthews. Meanwhile, out on the floor, new leader is Reagan Huckabee. She is in lane number two on the right side, very top of the screen in yellow and blue. And she now is in a tie with Alethea Boone. You'll see the minus number also in those red boxes on the top of the screen. That indicates how many reps behind the lead the athlete is.
Something I'm excited to see about this particular event is the mix and match of muscle-ups and light snatches. Now, it's high-volume light snatches, but there's so many different ways I think this workout can be dissected and attacked, whether you're super proficient at muscle-ups, maybe you go unbroken and go singles on your snatches. You're not very good at muscle-ups. Okay, you're gonna break it up into a couple sets and touch and go more on the snatches.
Carlene Matthews, you take a look back here, she's speaking with Adrian Bosman, one of the head judges here of the games, and seems to not, it seems to be in good spirits, but again, we pointed out there's already been two athletes that have withdrawn from the competition, and Carlene Matthews. Not sure what's happening there. Obviously, there's some distress there, some injury. We'll try to get word to you as soon as we can. Still gonna get back onto the rings.
And you see that left arm, there's something not right about that left side, just not being able to keep the elbow in tight and lock out the rep itself.
She's got to be worried about the minimum work requirement of 2 rounds complete, which would be the round of 11, which is currently underway for the leaders. Alethea Boone on the left, Reagan Huckabee on the right.
And Alethea in round 1 went unbroken on the muscle-ups and then opted to break up the snatches from there, though, you know, and I like this technique. It's kind of something that I would probably do myself if I were attacking this workout, is that, you know, being very good at muscle-ups, great. Be good, go unbroken, maybe break it up into 2 sets. You can move pretty fast on consistent singles when it comes to the snatch. Now, one thing to note is that they do have to receive this in a full squat, unlike just going touch and go and pulling it off the ground and not catching it below parallel.
Your leader's on the left side of the split screen, currently in 4th in the heat. 5 reps behind is Margot Alvarez on the right. Mentioned earlier, it's a bit of a surprise to see her here in heat number 1. This is an athlete that's been in the top 10 in a game's finish in her career.
Well, when you think about the 2 events we've had earlier this morning, we had a run, swim, run, and a bike event. That is a very niche style programming when it comes to running, swimming especially, and running again. And then you throw in something like a bike course, you know, it just might not fit the skill set that Margot has herself, but I have no doubt whatsoever that she is going to start clawing her way back when we start getting more into these traditional style events here at the CrossFit Games.
So 2 rounds complete now for Alethea Boone and Reagan Huckabee, 4 seconds apart from each other. Margot Alvarez holding on to the 3rd position currently by about a rep over Jessica Coughlin in 4th. Boone with the quicker transition. This is the beginning of the round of 9.
Now, this is the first time Boone's broke since the first part of this particular event. She went unbroken 13, unbroken 11, and now she went sets of 3. Huckabee, on the flip side, has been doing more breaking up in the beginning, where you're talking about 2 or 3 sets. But on the barbell side, Boone's been doing singles to make up for those unbroken sets on the muscle-ups, where Huckabee is still keeping the same number of sets. She's doing more touch-and-go reps on the snatches than Boone is, and that's what I said, is there's so many different ways you can tackle this event. This is just heat 1. You're going to see a variety of ways this is going to go down across the board as we move from heat to heat to heat.
And as we watch the lead battle, just to get everybody caught up to speed on Carlene Matthews, she has signed a scorecard and left the floor, so her event and likely her competition is over. But the event continues for the leaders. Alethea Boone out in front, 5 reps now, 4 reps ahead of Reagan Huckabee, putting the finishing touches on her set of 9 muscle-ups.
This is where traditional Amanda starts, is the round of 9, 9-7-5. This event has turned into basically a dead sprint. Now, not this one we're watching right now, but traditional Amanda, where it's unbroken everything or you're gonna lose. Here, starting with 13-11, traditional Amanda, 21 total reps. They added 24 to the front end of this event. So this has definitely turned into more of a war of attrition than just a dead sprint down the floor.
Alvarez has moved into the 2nd position here in the heat by 1 rep over Reagan Huckabee, as she had a quicker transition from the rings to the bar. But during that fight for 2nd, Alethea Boone on the far left of the screen continuing to pull away. And she is through the round of 9 and on to round number 4, the round of 7.
And she's doing it with singles on the snatches. She came out really hot early on the muscle-ups because she could, because she was good at it. But even in the round of 13, she was doing singles. Here's the issue when you go touch and go too early when you shouldn't. Even if you were to decide to go back to singles, you're so tired by that point and your grip is shot, that even your breaks in between singles are slower than the athlete who started there. Personally, I'd probably try to stick with singles from the start, maybe in the warm-up area, feel it out, time it, and get an assessment of how your hands, grip feel, and your heart rate.
40 seconds, the interval from first place Alethea Boone to second place Margot Alvarez. Reagan Huckabee now onto round four as well. That number on the top of the screen, you're looking for the number 90. That would be the final rep on the floor in that set of five snatches in round number five. These are the snatches in round number four for Boone on the left of the screen.
Like her Margot, who's on the right side, is that she broke her muscle up early. You know, it's not one of her strongest movements, but at the same time, she stuck with the singles on the snatches from the start. So she's able to move past Huckabee, who opted for kind of that touch and go on the snatches in the earlier part.
One rep remains in round number four for Alethea Boone, and what a difference a year makes. It was about this day 1 year ago on the Saturday night event, 100%. Box jumps and medicine D-ball cleans, where she ruptured her Achilles tendon during the box jump portion of the event. She wasn't likely to make regionals, let alone really compete in the Open this year. 6 months after she ruptured her Achilles, she did the Open. She managed to qualify for regionals. She thought, there's a big goal attained. That'd be great for this season. She managed to qualify for the Games as well 9 months after rupturing her Achilles tendon. And here she is in heat number one, likely setting the time for the rest of these heats to beat.
What a way to bounce back, because it was the big stage where she ended up hurting herself. Now she's sitting in 39th, 40th overall because of those earlier movements, but you're probably not doing a lot of running and biking off of a ruptured Achilles. But
here, not breaking up the reps on the bar, Alethea Boone, welcome back to the Games. 9 minutes, 25.08 seconds. And you let out those tears of joy, Alethea. Welcome back.
And that's the Alethea that we've been waiting to see. I know she didn't finish or start the way she did when you're talking about the runs, the bikes, but if you think about it, that's not really movements you're gonna be able to do too much of coming off and recovering from a ruptured Achilles. So, you know, 5K run, hard bike, that's not something you're gonna be doing as a recovery. But to be able to come back here, rings, squat snatches, it's good to see her back. And you can see by the look on her face how happy she is to be back here on the stage.
Second place still held by Margot Alvarez, a minute 11 seconds behind the pace of Alethea Boone. Alvarez on the right. She is about five reps ahead of Reagan Huckabee, who held a top three spot for the most part. Alexis Johnson is moving into that position as well. Alvarez on the front of the screen will be the second place athlete in the heat at 10 minutes and 35.99 seconds. Now the fight is for third between Alexis Johnson and Reagan Huckabee. Simultaneously, and actually it was a no rep for Alexis Johnson, had to go back to the rings, so she'll give up a little bit of time. And that allows Reagan Huckabee on the left side of the screen to regain the third place position here in the heat. It's Huckabee on the left, Johnson on the right. Huckabee going for five touch and go reps. She will get that done successfully and jump up onto the platform at 11 minutes and 15 seconds.
That's when you want to save a few touch and go reps in your back pocket when you're looking at that round of seven and that round of five.
Alexis Johnson, another one of the athletes that was looking forward to seeing a little bit more, hate to use this term, but traditional CrossFit style workouts. And she capitalizes with a fourth place finish in the heat. Maddie Sturt, the youngest athlete in the field for the second consecutive year, will round out the top five here in heat number one. Jessica Coughlin, been close to getting here so many times. Never has finished worse than eighth at regionals. A sixth, a sixth, a sixth, and then an eighth last year out of the Pacific Regional. Finally getting her shot at the Games this time. And she'll take a sixth place finish here in heat number one. last athlete left, and off camera we were talking about who we thought would do well, and I thought Casey Campbell could be somebody that does well. She's a gymnastics coach, two-time American Open weightlifting qualifier. This would be a good combination, but you got to add in a whole lot of other elements to that.
Well, a gymnastics coach is deceiving when it comes to the females side of that competition floor, because they don't do ring muscle-ups in women's gymnastics. Now, if this was a bar, yes, you'd probably see Casey Campbell up there in the top of the field, but ring muscle-ups isn't something that women gymnasts do traditionally in their training.
Five reps left for Campbell, who after the West Regional posted on social media, "I think I accidentally qualified for the CrossFit Games." She was one of those Cinderella stories this year, and we saw many of them during regionals this year. Little under 2 minutes until the 15-minute time cap, which will not be a threat for the CrossFit Seven Cities athlete out of Washington. She's up on the platform at 13 minutes and 20 seconds, and we'll have seven finishers here in the heat, all led by Alethea Boone. And we cannot say enough about the difference that has happened since her injury 1 year ago. And not only did she take the heat, she took it in blistering fashion, a minute 10 seconds faster than second place Margo Alvarez.
Well, there's one thing you know about Alethea Boone is that she can pull her body up and down ropes, up and down the rings, and that singles on the snatch. Great technique, and this is her strong suit, that just upper body gymnastic pulling. That's an Alethea Boone wheelhouse type movement. So she maximized that in the very beginning when she went unbroken on the 13-11, stuck with the singles until the very end. Like I said, keep a couple touch and go reps in your back pocket in the round of five, maybe the round of seven. Alethea Boone, welcome back to the games.
Alethea, we saw the emotion on your face. You even hugged your judge. What was happening at that moment?
To be quite honest, I'm just so stoked to be here, to even have made the games. I've surpassed every goal that I've set this year, and to be here, I'm super proud. Yes, I'm happy to be here, but in words that I can compete, I'm trying to compete the best of my ability.
You've had a tough day so far with the first two events. This is a way that you can bounce back into this competition. You did so. How did this event compare to those other two earlier today for you?
So 8 weeks ago, when I made it to the games, I'd never ridden a bike properly. So I actually just learned to ride a bike. And I've just started putting a bit more volume through my legs for running. I didn't really train swimming because I didn't think I'd make it to the games. So this whole morning was really, really hard. But I knew that put us in the Coliseum, I'll have a few words that I can go for.
And you did that. Alethea, thank you.
Thank you.
It's just good to see Alethea Boone back after what happened a year ago. And not only are we seeing her back, we're seeing her back in good form here in this event. She leads the way through heat one of four, with heat number two coming up next. The energy and the action is building here at the Alliant Energy Center in Madison, Wisconsin, with event number 3 on the women's side of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games, Amanda 45 with heat number 2 coming up next. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingerman, Amanda Krenz with you here at the Coliseum's floor as we saw one heat already take on this challenge, and it's that new twist on a timeless games event.
It's a challenge and it's a tribute to Amanda Miller, the first event they had at the StubHub Center when they moved from the ranch to Carson, California. Now we're in Madison, we're stepping it up a little bit. Instead of 9.75, we're going 13 and 11 in front of that, adding 24 total reps to the original 21.
And even though it's heat 2, look at the names we have in this one. We see Alessandra Pacelli, Brooke Wells, Emily Abbott, Stacy Tovar, Emily Bridgers, several big names in this one, but the one you might want to keep your eye on the most is in lane number 9, Carrie Pierce.
I think Carrie Pierce should fare pretty well when you're talking about these two type of movements, high volume upper body pulling gymnastics and snatches. So Carrie Pierce should be one of those athletes to claw herself out of that 29th place position.
Somebody else that struggled through day number 1 thus far looking to make that move is your Atlantic regional champion, Cassidy Lance McWhorter.
Well, you know, those first two events, you know, she's a very aggressive competitor, and it's hard to do in movements that you're not really familiar with, especially when you move outside the gym. This is traditional Cassidy Lance type stuff.
And while those two are well-rounded for this one, somebody that might be a bit of a question mark on one of these movements is Brooke Wells.
Well, the question is, did you work on what you are supposed to be working on in the off-season? It's not lifting, it's not anything like that. It's, have you worked on your gymnastic skills?
The round of 13 is underway, and the time to beat 9 minutes 25.08 seconds set by Alethea Boone in heat number 1. We start with these 13 ring muscle-ups.
We got 45 total reps of ring muscle-ups and squat snatches at 95 pounds. You see a lot of athletes breaking through on that first set of 13, and I think that's very smart, especially if this isn't a strong movement for you. Break up the sets early, and I mean that for both ring muscle-ups and snatches, because traditional Amanda with the 9.75, it's an unbroken race to the finish line. But when you're talking about high-volume snatches mixed with these ring muscle-ups, is that upper body pulling could kill you on the backside. So use your legs when you're snatching. It's not a heavy weight, but it is a lot of reps.
And the first to use their legs on the snatch portion of this opening round is Emily Bridgers, the athlete out of Atlanta, Georgia, CrossFit Terminus. You see her name highlighted in blue. That's because she is the current leader. Everybody else will be in red with the minus number indicating how many reps they are behind the lead. So Bridgers in the purple and yellow combination in the middle of the screen through 7 of the 13 snatches in round number 1. They're working towards rep number 90, which is the total amount of reps in this event.
One thing that's kind of hard to do when you're talking about 13 squat snatches at 95 is doing singles and having the patience to continue to do singles. It takes a long time, it seems, to get through this rep, especially if someone's gonna rip off 13 touch and go reps next to you. But this is a long workout in terms of you have 45 total reps of this. You think about your traditional Isabel where it's 30 snatches at this weight where you can power it. Now you're squatting and you're doing 1.5 times that. Oh, by the way, throw in 45 ring muscle-ups while you're at it. So they need to take their time early, establish a good pace that's comfortable for them. And then when you get to the 9.75, you can start turning it up just a little bit.
Bridgers out in front, one of the athletes that she trains with regularly, a programming teammate, making her 8th and final games appearance as an individual. Stacy Tovar in the center of the screen, currently sitting in 4th. She was there in 2010 when this event first came out at the games back in California, the first nighttime event there. First nighttime event here as well in Madison. Right side of the screen in purple and yellow, that is Emily Bridger. She's the leader. leading the way over Cassidy Lance McWhorter, who is in second, four reps back. And Emily Abbott, bit of a surprise there with the high rep muscle ups, sitting in third.
It is. It definitely didn't play to her strong suit at the West Regional, but I think she had a very good wake-up call. We're talking about Emily Abbott there in the West, is that, you know, she had a lot of no reps that weekend, and I think, you know, she took that as kind of a positive, is that, you know, if you were going to perform against the best, you need to perform at your best. And it's less about just going fast and muscling through things and really being efficient with your movement. Snatches and ring muscle ups, you have to be efficient with your movement, technique wise. And you got Bridgers and Lance out there side by side. It's just, look, you want to keep the bar close, you want to move your feet, catch it in a good position. What you don't want to do is catch it with, say, a bent elbow and start pressing reps out. You're going to need that movement, that overhead press and stability on the ring. So these movements really conflict with each other. It's one of my favorite workouts they have.
Halfway point is completed for Emily Bridgers. She's through 45 of the 90 reps. At rep 48, she'll move on to round number three, which, as you said early on, or in heat number one, that's really where this event takes place.
And I said, we tacked on 13 and 11, and as we move from that to the round of nine, this is your traditional Amanda, 9.75. Now, they're not going to be going as fast as they would if it was just the pure 9.75, because they've done 24 muscle-ups and squat snatches up to this point. What I like to see Emily's been doing is that she knows her breaks, she knows how long to rest. They've gone over this before, even though they've only heard it for about a couple hours. These athletes have been in the game for long enough time as they know what they can do, how long they should rest, and if they can adapt as needed.
Bridgers continuing to lead. She's on the right. On the left of the split screen is Cassidy Lance McWhorter. This is an Atlantic regional battle that was fantastic all weekend long in Atlanta a couple of months ago. And here it is again in heat number two and event number three.
Bridges on the right side has been breaking her sets up into fours and threes. And as you move into nine and seven, she's going for three sets of three. Looks like Cassie's doing the same thing, breaking at three reps on her first set.
While the Atlantic Regional was going, the West Regional was going at the same time. And one of the athletes that qualified out of that one is here, Emily Abbott, making her fourth consecutive trip to the games this year.
She looks very comfortable on the rings for Emily Abbott. So I really like her positioning. Big chest swing on the way through.
And we mentioned early on, one of the athletes you definitely need to keep an eye on in this one is Carrie Pierce. There she is in yellow and black. She's moved into the third position and has drawn level with Cassidy Lance McWhorter for second. That all eight reps behind Emily Bridgers. She's looking to go wire to wire here in this one as she's working on the round of nine snatches, which will be rep number 66 of 90. Two rounds remain for Emily Bridgers. The round of seven and the round of five is all that's left.
She did three sets of three on the round of nine. And I'll say one thing is, once you come off the snatches, especially when you're doing singles, it gives you enough break to feel a little bit more recovered when you get to the rings. Now, if you're going touch and go, there is no break. Your grip's more fatigued. Your shoulders are more fatigued than they were when you got off the rings. The nice thing about doing singles, especially when you get to these shorter rep schemes, is that you get a little bit of a recovery in between your sets.
Pace slowing a bit for Bridgers, and that could open the window for either Carrie Pierce or here in the center of the screen, Cassidy Lance McWhorter. Final round for Emily Bridgers, and that pace slowing a bit, but it might be, last two rounds on the snatches underway for her. That pace starting to slow, but she might have opened up enough of a lead early on that it might not matter here in heat number two.
She might have been a little bit slower on the snatches where Lance and Pierce got to catch up, but her sets on the muscle-ups were good. Her rest was very consistent. and then staying this smooth single pace on the squat snatches, keeping the bar close, catching in a good position. You don't want to rush this lift. We don't need to go fast. We just need to be consistent. And the idea is that making sure you're using your legs off the start, pulling it from the floor by standing, jumping the bar up and catching the bar. You don't want to pull and press. That's not going to work. You're already doing that on the rings. You don't need to do that on snatches.
80 reps down, 10 reps remain for Bridgers. 5 muscle ups, 5 snatches, all that's left. Cassidy Lance McWhorter now finds herself in third, 2 reps behind Carrie Pierce in second. Bridgers back onto the rings. 2 muscle ups remain. She'll break off 3 of the 5 here in the final round. Pierce onto the barbell first in this fight for second place. But the leader continues to be Emily Bridgers with 1 muscle up remaining. She'll get the lockout in advance of the barbell. She's got about 35 seconds to catch the time of Alethea Boone at 9 minutes and 25.08 seconds in heat number 1.
I said this in the last heat. Keep some touch and go reps in your back pocket for the end of this event.
Emily Bridgers has yet to win an event in her games career, but she's put herself in position to do so. New time to beat, 9 minutes, 8.36 seconds. For second place, that position currently held by Carrie Pierce on the right side of the screen. She's through the muscle ups into the barbell. Cassidy Lance McWhorter is just making her way to the rings now. So Pierce should be in good position for second in the heat and what looks to be third in the event. She had issues with the bike as the chain came off in that event number 2. Gave her some issues. She's a little bit lower on the leaderboard than she wants to be, but a solid finish for Pierce at 9:51.
And she just slowly did things just a little bit quicker than Cassidy did. And it wasn't much and it wasn't very dramatic, but it was a half a second here, a half a second there, and that's what would turn the tide for Carrie Pierce.
So first place, University of Georgia gymnast. Second place, University of Michigan gymnast. Third place, University of Washington gymnast, Cassidy Lance McWhorter. We talk about the significance of this event. It was the first one that we had at the StubHub Center in Carson, California. This is the first one that we have here in the Coliseum setting of the Alliant Energy Center in Madison, Wisconsin. Somebody that's seen it all since the ranch, Stacy Tovar, in her 8th games appearance, will take a 4th place finish here in heat number 2. Fifth place, we got a nice one here between Danny Horan in the center of the screen. She makes her way to the barbell. 1 rep ahead of Carly Fuhrer, who's on the opposite end of the floor. And with the speed of the reps for Horan on the left, looks like she'll be able to hold off Fuhrer for 5th. Carly Fuhrer, 2 reps remaining, make it 1 left. There is a 1 rep added here on the minus 1, which is just reaching the finish platform, which Fuhrer does at 11 minutes and 32 seconds. So for 7th place, we've got a close one here between Emily Abbott and Alessandra Bocelli. Abbott to the bar first, she'll get through 1, make it 2 reps before Bocelli picks up her first of 5. And Emily Abbott will hold off the 2016 CrossFit Liftoff winner. Abbott in 7th, Bocelli in 8th. And we asked the question early on if Brooke Wells worked on the gymnastics, if she can shore up a weakness. And Wells and Jessica Griffith are the last 2 remaining on the floor.
I haven't said her name since the beginning part of this event. I've just been curious, I haven't been able to see exactly what's been holding her up, but if we look back on the past, it has been high volume gymnastics.
And Wells down to singles on the muscle ups, which isn't a bad strategy if if this is a weakness of yours. You don't want to miss any reps, but it's definitely a sign that this is still a deficiency.
Yeah, we definitely don't want to blow up too early when you're not doing any muscle-ups towards the end. But, you know, some of these things is you just got to mitigate your weaknesses, take your licks, and move on to the next event. She's going to have hers because we do have some heavy lifts coming later down the road.
And off the rings, back to the bar for Brooke Wells. Five reps remain now, four. Still has about 2 minutes until the time cap. That not a concern for one of the youngest athletes in the field, just 22 years old, Brooke Wells, in her third straight games appearance, ninth place here in heat number two. The final athlete on the floor, we spoke about in heat number one, Casey Campbell being one of the Cinderella stories out of regionals this year. Another one was Jessica Griffith, who the entire time, everybody kept going, all right, when's she gonna drop off? She stayed in the top five that whole weekend in a loaded Central Regional. And here she is, the last athlete left with about 1 minute until the cap. Do wanna make a correction, that time cap is a 18 minute time cap, not 15, apologies there.
And she's moving into a round of seven, sticking with singles, trying to keep a consistent pace. And I think one thing to note is that Brooke Wells has gotten much better at her, you know, ring muscle-ups and gymnastics skills. There's just a lot of good girls in this particular heat at the same time. And you're talking Bridgers, Pierce, Tovar, Horan, Abbott, you know, Cassie, Lance, McWhirter. I mean, those are some girls who are known for their ring muscle-ups and barbell work. So, you know, it might have looked a little worse than it actually was for Brooke Wells.
As is the case for Jessica Griffith, fifth place athlete out of the Central Regional, made her individual regional debut this season. The same year she makes her individual games debut. And the fittest female nurse on earth in the 2017 Open will be the lone athlete unable to beat the 15-minute time cap that horn just sounded. So heat number two closes with 9 of 10 athletes being able to beat the cap. But our new leader through 2 of 4 heats is Emily Bridgers at 9:08.36.
And I really enjoyed watching Emily Bridgers work her way through this from the start. She was doing fours, sets of threes, taking a short break here and there. Very good on the rings, but you don't need to do big sets when you're good. I say this a lot, especially with my athletes at my own affiliate, is that, look, if you're good, just be good. You don't have to do anything out of the ordinary. Don't go unbroken on the 11. You don't need to. Just make 4, 4, and 3 the easiest reps you've ever done, and then work on the barbell. And then in the last set of 5, like I said, if you can do consistent singles, keep the rep or the rest scheme very small in between those resets. Save a little touch and go in your pocket. If you need it, throttle towards the finish, get yourself a heat win.
Emily, you know this tribute workout. What did you think though when you found out you're adding rounds and so many more reps?
Well, I've been dying for Amanda to be released for years now. It was actually 2011 regionals was my very first competition and we did it there. I failed at a 1,000 snatches in that workout, but I've always loved it ever since, just pushing myself over and over again. And for a great person from what I hear, and it was special to be brought back, and it definitely was a huge added component of difficulty. So I thought it was really cool.
You had a couple hours to think this through. So how did you decide to strategize for this?
Well, my strategy just did not go as planned. I had my muscle ups like strategized out and then all singles on the barbell. I stuck to it for this first set and as much as I could, but I just went on the fly and did what I needed to do when my grip started to go. We didn't know that it was going to be men's barbells, so that was a little added difficulty, a little more grip, especially when you have small hands. But it worked out.
So good job out there.
Hope for the best now.
Thanks, Emily.
Thank you.
In a battle of gymnasts, the win goes to Emily Bridgers out of the University of Georgia. She's got the new time to beat at 9:08.36. Two heats remain. Heat number three is next. Two heats down, two heats remain in women's event number three of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Welcome to the Coliseum at Madison, Wisconsin's Alliant Energy Center. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Amanda Krenz with you. And we've seen some fast times set by some solid, solid gymnasts. And we're going to see a lot of heavy lifters here in heat number three as they take on a new twist on Amanda.
Oh, bringing back the rings. And hey, hello, barbells. Welcome back to the stage as we are going ring muscle ups and squat snatches of 95 pounds. Tossing on 24 extra reps to traditional Amanda, starting with that 13 and 11.
Here in heat number three, we spoke about how star-studded heat two was. Heat three not lacking in star power as well, including the two-time champion Annie Thorestadter in lane number five. But if you want some big lifters, look no farther than lane number eight, Carl Webb.
Well, did someone say cycling light barbells? Okay, hello, Cara Webb. It's good to see you again. I'm curious to see how she handles the muscle-ups relative to the barbell weight. She might be one of those athletes who break up the muscle-ups a little bit more and goes touch and go on the barbell.
There's three daughters that get a lot of attention. There's a fourth one in the field, and she could be a sleeper pick in this one, Turi Helgadottir.
Hey, I can be a little biased sometimes. Helgadottir might be my favorite daughter out there because I just think she's underappreciated and underrated when it comes to being a fierce competitor. She will do well in this event. I'm excited to see what she can do out there.
Somebody else that's very fierce in terms of competitiveness, China Cho.
Well, she was there in 2010 when they unveiled this workout when it was just 975 squat snatches and ring muscle up. So I know she wants another crack at this on the big stage.
Stand by. 13, 11, 9, 7, 5. Two movements, it starts with ring muscle ups.
When you have 13, that's a pretty big set for a lot of these athletes. And you think about some of their max muscle-ups in a row, 13 would probably be up there for some of their max in a row. So breaking it up early, even if your max is, say, 15 to 17, I still don't think there's any reason to do 13 unbroken muscle-ups. This is a very long workout with lots of reps. I know 10 minutes might not seem long, but when you're talking about a couplet, two specific movements, that's a long workout.
Top of the screen, you'll notice that box in blue, which has changed a lot. Currently, the athlete highlighted in blue is Caroline Reason-Tebow. She's highlighted in blue because she's the event leader. That number will indicate how many reps she's completed. Everybody else will be in red, with a minus number showing how many reps they are behind.
One of the fastest splits we've seen is 45.5. She's 48.60, so she might have had just one break on that round of 13.
That would be Carol Ann Reason-Tebow in lane number three. She's at the top of the screen in gray and black. There's a look at Carol Ann on the right. Turi Helgadottir in the middle. Val Voberl, another one of the athletes that did compete in 2010, the first time this event was unveiled in its original version, is on the left.
I said before, singles are a great idea when you're talking about the first part of this event. 13, 11, 24 total squat snatches with muscle-ups in between, but you need to be fast between your reps. There's no time to set up as if it's a one-rep max where you kind of plant one foot, the other, grab with the right hand and the left, keep your chest up and go. You got to be in a position where you can just grab and go. Keep your chest up, keep your chin up, use the legs, jump and catch, get underneath that bar.
I feel like this is becoming a trend this season, but you always kind of underestimate Carol Ann Reason-Tebow when it comes to events. She did it in the East Regional this year. She got overlooked because of Katrin Davidsdottir and Carrie Pierce, and she won that regional. Here she is again after round number one, and she's out in front here in heat
three.
Look
at that massive layout. She has that lean forward with the chest, but what's more importantly when you're talking about being proficient with the rings is it's not just the swing through, but it's the swing back. And what she does so well is that she gets back and just sweeps the rings underneath her and pulls straight in. That is a fantastic technique when it comes to those massive pulls on the rings.
Carol Ann Reason-Tebow continuing to lead the way by one rep over Cara Webb, who off to a slow start this year, especially from what we're used to seeing from her when it comes to day one competition at the games.
Well, Carl Webb not in the final heat, though she's pretty closely in heat 3 of 4. What I like to see is how she handles maybe breaking up these sets early and then moving on the bar a bit quicker than you'd probably see the other athletes do. That's not a heavy weight for her to touch and go a few times.
Speaking of the bar, that now in the hands of Carol Ann Reason-Thibault, continuing to lead 13 and a half seconds faster than the split through the round of 11 muscle-ups of Cara Webb on the right.
Now Cara opting for those singles, but they're a bit faster. Look at the rest time between. Cara's almost already done 2 for Carol Ann's 1, Carol Ann being on the left. Look at that, hand on, chest up, go. So they both hit it at the same exact time. Cara's hands are already on the bar and she's going. Reason Thibault, you're gonna lose a half a second a rep. Well, when you have 45 and 45, 90, that's nearly a whole minute lost just from losing a half a second every rep.
Reason Thibault at the midway point in terms of reps in this event. 45, now 46 completed of 90. Rep 48 is the end of round number 2, and we'll begin the round of 9, which is the third of 5 rounds. Thibault through at 424.2, 3 seconds now the interval between her and Cara Webb. Webb is, as expected, faster on the barbell than Reason Thibault.
But I said it was just by a half a second of repetition, but we just had 24 of those go by. I'm wondering how much Reason Thibault maybe should have broke up the first set of muscle-ups. Now she goes for a set of 3, Cara doing the same thing. Whereas we trickle down to the 9.75 portion of this, you might start seeing the rest in between sets increase a little bit more. And to me, that's not worth the unbroken sets earlier in this event.
Something to keep an eye on in round number 2, a second and a half slower was Cara Webb on the muscle-ups, but she was 9.8 seconds faster on the snatches in the round of 11. New leader is Cara Webb by 1 rep over Carol Ann Reason-Thibault. And there's a couple of athletes that both of them are trying to hold off. And that includes the 2-time champion Annie Thorisdottir on the left and China Cho on the right.
I like those big sweeping muscle-ups for Annie Thorisdottir there in the blue, just left of China Cho in lane 5 and lane 6. But you see her laboring a little bit over it. Now, if you're gonna rest, that's not the position that I would say to rest in, kind of that bend over. We kind of see her do her that a lot. That's gonna cut off a lot of, let's say, lung capacity that you need to recover in that position. As, you know, Thibault and Webb still going side by side, but as I said, the cycle time on Webb is just a little bit faster. I think Thibault might have saw that. You see, taking a step back, top part of your screen as Webb picks it up again. So Webb is just, she's not going any faster. She's just resting a little bit less than Thibault is.
Our scoring tracker is getting a workout on the top of the screen, flipping between Cara Webb and Carol Ann Reason-Thibault when it comes to the lead. They're working towards rep 66 in round number 3, and the lead has changed only about 10 times in this set of 9 snatches.
See that hand in hand on the right side of your screen for Cara Webb. I really like her pace when it comes to these singles on the snatches.
Webb to round number 4 first, 1 rep ahead of Carol Ann Reason-Thibault. New third place athlete, center of the screen in blue and black, Annie Thorisdottir.
But Annie does well as she keeps her hands on the bar when she puts the bar down. Look, she pushes the bar down, hand, chest up, and go. What this does for an athlete is that the one thing you don't want to do is step away from the bar. Even if you know how much you're going to rest, they could rest the same amount. There's some mental aspect when you're talking about keeping your hands on the bar just forces you to start a little bit sooner than you naturally would by stepping back from the bar.
Something to keep in mind, in the first 2 heats, the top time was 9 minutes, 8.36 seconds. That about 90 seconds from now. Webb on the right, Reason-Thibault on the left. That's the lead battle. Annie Thorisdottir sitting in third. And we speak about the historical references of this event. There's no more iconic moment, perhaps, at the ranch era than Annie Thorstadter fighting for her first ever muscle up. Here she is, moving to the third home of the games and sitting in third place here in Heat 3. Right side of the split is Kara Webb. She's three reps clear on Carol Ann Reason-Tebow, who continues to hang on to the second position ahead of Thorstadter. Ten reps remain, five muscle ups, five snatches. All that's left for Kara Webb. 38 seconds until the time to beat, which looks pretty safe for Emily Bridgers from heat number two.
Kara had to break down to singles in the lighter part of that round of seven. But if you can knock out a three and a two here, there is a shot. You know, five reps, probably not good enough getting the top time, but if she can hang on here and touch and go at the end, that should be good enough for a second place.
Definitely in line for second, which is currently 925.08 from Alethea Boone in round number one. Fellow Pacific Regional athlete Kara Webb looking to pass her, but she'll get a no rep, which could open the window for Reason-Tebow, who's now through the muscle-ups. I take that back. One rep remaining on the muscle-ups for Reason-Tebow. So Kara Webb in position to take the heat. Won't be the top time, won't be the second fastest time. Third quickest thus far is Carrie Pearson, 9:51. Make that Kara Webb at 9:33.
I want to say I'm surprised she didn't go touch and go at the end, but we heard earlier is that they're actually using a men's thickness bar, so maybe being able to hold on and be, you know, hold on to that bar for touch and go reps wasn't in the cards for Kara Webb.
Carol Ann Reason-Tebow, three reps, now two reps remain, trying to hold on to a top five provisional spot with one heat remaining. That currently held by Cassidy Lance McWhorter at 10:20.17. About 10 seconds till that point. Reason-Tebow stands it up, gets a no rep for leaving the box that she has to be in on the floor, and that could cost her a position. And the East Regional champion will be second in the heat, unofficially sixth in the event at 10:21.89. Annie Thorstadter having to hold off fellow countrywoman Turi Helgadottir on the left side of the split. Two reps, the differential between the two. Annie to the bar first, looking to go unbroken for the set of five to close it out. And the 2011 and 2010 CrossFit Games champ, 2012 CrossFit Games champion will drop the bar, make her way to the platform at just under 11 minutes, third place in the heat. China Cho trying to close in on Turi Helgadottir. Helgadottir on the top of the screen, Cho on the near side of the screen, give the position to Turi Helgadottir. China Cho rounds out the top five here in heat number three. Two muscle-ups remain for both Lauren Fisher and Valerie Voberl. Fisher, you saw a moment ago in lane number nine. Voberl now to the barbell. One of the youngest qualifiers in the field, Lauren Fisher, just graduated from San Diego State University, against the oldest athlete in the field, Valerie Voberl, who turns 39 this weekend. Fisher on the right, Voberl on the left. They drop the bar simultaneously. The sprint is onto the platform. We'll have to go to the chip timer. And by a tenth of a second, give it to Valerie Voberl. Three athletes left on the floor with about 2 minutes, 40 seconds. Until the 15-minute time cap, first of those three is Whitney Yalin. The 2015 Games athlete failed to qualify last year out of the East Regional, went back home to the Atlantic, and took a fourth place finish in those five qualifying spots for the Games. And she'll be our eighth place finisher. well known for the softball slide across the podium a couple of years ago. It wasn't as dramatic this time. A couple of games rookies remain. Mackenzie Riley closing out the muscle ups. ...29-year-old registered dietitian out of CrossFit Northlake in Charlotte, North Carolina. With three snatches, now two snatches remaining. She was a team athlete last year with the fifth place team, CrossFit OC3. And here in her individual debut, ninth place in heat number three. And Kirsten Pedry be the final athlete. A couple of snatches remaining for her. And the 35-year-old out of CrossFit Davis, she had a spot locked up in Masters competition. She went on and qualified for the Open Division. To cap that off as well, she'll be our 10th and final finisher under the time cap. The heat winner, Carl Webb, 9 minutes, 34.56 seconds.
That was quite the start to this event, especially for this particular heat. We had a good back and forth between Reason Thibault and Cara Webb. Thibault was out very quick, very early in that round of 13 and 11, but it was Webb, who's on the right side, bottom part of your screen, was just cycling those snatches just a little bit quicker, especially in the higher rounds of 11 and 9. Had to break them up a little bit more on the muscle-ups towards the end, but it was that final set of five. Just a consistent pace all the way through, and that's what you want to see for an event like this. With this many reps at this high skill movements, good steady pace all the way through.
It's a little surprising to see Cara Webb sitting in 16th in the point standings, but she'll look to make her way back up the leaderboard with 3 days remaining here in heat number three. She takes this one at 9:34.56 seconds, good for the third fastest time thus far. With 10 athletes remaining, we'll have heat four coverage coming up next. It's a new home, it's a new era, but the energy still feels the same. Heat 4, Event 3 in the women's side of the competition at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games is here in Madison, Wisconsin. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Amanda Krenz with you as we put on this new twist from a classic and timeless tribute of a Games workout.
Well, you wanted Amanda back at the Games. You got it, plus a little extra. We're going 13-11-975 of ring muscle-ups and squat snatches at 95 pounds. You're upping it up. That's a lot of reps.
Here in heat number 4, we will have our top 10 athletes after the opening two events, and that includes our points leader will be in lane number 5, Samantha Briggs.
Sam Briggs does this a lot, right? Very early on, she's always sitting up there in that top position. I want to see if she can hang on. She's been outside looking in the last 2 years in fourth place back to back.
There's a look at our points leader, Sam Briggs, as she makes her way onto the floor for the very first time here at the Alliant Energy Center. She'll be easy to spot in that white and red leader's jersey. She's yet to win an event here this weekend, but third place, second place, that's as good as winning events at this point.
Well, she's trending up. That's the direction you want to go, right?
Second place athlete, she's in that familiar position. Two-time second place athlete in the Games, Tia Toomey.
Toomey is one of those athletes who's capitalized very much so on the first two events of the weekend. And now as we get into that, you know, we're throwing the barbell back out there in the rings. It's good to see her back up in there. I want to see what Sarah can do as well. She's been on the outside. You know, I say outside looking in, she's got third 2 years in a row, but she wants to win. She has the capability of doing so, and it's going to start here tonight in the Coliseum.
And we're underway for the first time in that final heat of event number 3 here in Madison. It starts with 13 ring muscle-ups. We'll decrease the reps 2 reps every round.
One thing I'm curious to see is lane 5. You have Sam Briggs in the white and red pants. Is that if anyone's going to go unbroken the whole way through, it is Sam Briggs. I'm not saying she should. I just know that she can. She's not as proficient on the barbell with something as technical as a squat snatch, so she needs to make her hay here on the rings.
You'll note on the top of the screen, the leader's name will be highlighted in blue. That currently is Sam Briggs in white and red, who barely had to come out of a dip on the top of the rings with a transition so strong.
Sam Briggs, it's the fastest split we've seen so far by over 3 seconds. And here's the singles. I like this. What is she probably the best at in all of CrossFit? It's ring muscle-ups or any upper body pulling movement. The girl, I mean, she can pull her body weight up and down, pretty much anything she needs to.
Biceps well, like Briggs for a reason.
Yeah, as well as that endurance factor, she showed that off earlier this morning. Now, something like a squat snatch at this weight isn't in her wheelhouse so much so as the ring. So look for her to capitalize here on the rings and these quick singles with the barbell.
You'll note her name no longer in blue. It's now in red with a -3. That's because she's 3 reps behind the new leader. And we speak about all the veteran experience here in the top 10 of the point standings. How about individual games rookie Jamie Green out in front in purple and gray?
Well, you see her out in front because she was slow off the rings, but she's going touch and go on the barbell. And that's the mistake you can make when you go too fast too soon. Being a rookie on the big stage by herself for the first time, she was on a team last year. There's a tale of two type of events. You got Jamie Green, who might have broke up the muscle ups a little bit in the beginning and went touch and go. Then you have Sam Briggs, who went unbroken on the muscle-ups and opted for singles.
Green the first one to the round of 11. She's 1 rep ahead of Tennille Reed-Burline in second. Sarah Sigmund's daughter, Tia Toomey, Sam Briggs, all in a rep-for-rep tie for third. Reed-Burline on the right side of the screen in blue and yellow. Those are the top 2 athletes, as Sarah Sigmund's daughter is on the right side of the split, making her move towards the lead as well.
Green broke at 5. Sigmund's daughter the same. Briggs.
New leader once again is off screen, and it's because Sam Briggs got to the rings, and she's yet to let go.
And don't be surprised to see that a lot as this event goes on, but you're going to see it a little bit more in these bigger rounds of the high volume muscle-ups where Briggs will make a charge through. What's going to be good for her is that if she can maintain that unbroken on the rings, as the reps decrease on the snatches, it isn't going to penalize her quite as much if some of these girls continue to go touch and go on the barbell.
Here in this heat, the person that runs our scoring ticker is hoping they get paid by the adjustment. We're going to see a lot of changes with the muscle up strength and the snatch strength that we've got for some of these athletes being so vastly different. Briggs out in front. She's working towards rep 48, which will indicate the end of round two. 90 reps total in this event as they try to chase down the top time of 908.36 seconds set by Emily Bridgers way back in heat number two.
Now Briggs still moving with the singles that she started with in the round of 13. Toomey to her right has started with singles as well. Now Jamie Green moved ahead of both of these athletes earlier up in lane number two by going touch and go. That's no longer happening. And I said earlier, if you're gonna start touch and go, you better know what you're doing and not think you're gonna buy yourself some time. It's only the first 13 reps of 45 total reps with 32 left. Dropping down to singles after that isn't the most advantageous if you started too soon.
And Green, a individual competition rookie. She stood on the podium of the team side with CrossFit Yaz 1 year ago, finishing third place. She's no stranger to this environment, but you always got a question when you're a rookie. First time you get this electric atmosphere here on a nighttime event. If that will rattle you a little bit, maybe she bit off a little bit more than she could chew.
And she also won the Open 2 years ago, you know, so she's no stranger to elite level competition. You know, these athletes meet each other outside of the games season very often throughout the year. But, you know, and that's just been one of those where you thought she could do more than you did. Everyone's going to feel good in the round of 13, but don't let that throw you off what you know you should probably do, and that's break things up a little early.
Only 30 seconds separate first through fifth through the second round. Top five now working on the round of 9 muscle-ups, 9 snatches. Leader is Jamie Green once again on the left side of the split. Make that Sam Briggs in white and red. Tia Toomey continuing to sit in the top three. She's in the yellow shorts and yellow shoes on the right side of the split.
Now we're moving into the round of 9. This is where Amanda traditionally starts 9.75. Briggs and Green both did 5 and 4. Green steps up to the barbell a little bit sooner there at the top part of your screen.
And this is the first time that Jamie Green had a faster split on the muscle-ups than Sam Briggs, and she did so 8 seconds quicker than Briggs that time through the round of 9.
Now, one thing that's going to be good for Jamie Green, she's on the left side, is that her singles are going to be much faster than Briggs towards the end just because she's more proficient with the movement. I would not count out Tia Claire Toomey, who's on the right side of Briggs on the top right part of your screen, who's going to be faster towards the end of these reps as well, especially if Briggs is going to start breaking on muscle-ups.
And the pink and black in lane number 7 on the right side of the screen is a name we haven't mentioned yet, and that's Christy Arimo, fourth place in the point standings. She's slowly creeping her way position by position through the field here in heat number 4. But 66 reps down, 24 reps remain for Jamie Green as she starts the round of 7. Tia Claire Toomey has moved into the second position, about a second ahead of the pace of Sam Briggs.
Now Green fell off the pace a little bit in the round of 11, where I was kind of nervous to say if she went out a little too hard. She did when she went unbroken on the first round of 13. She paid for it in the round of 11, but it looks like she's recovered since then. Those singles on the snatches in the round of 9 has moved her up into ahead and into contention for that top spot between her and Briggs.
You're looking for those boxes on top of the screen to show 80 reps this round. That will indicate that they're through 4 of the 5 rounds and onto that final round of 5 and 5. The muscle-ups are through here in round number 4 for Jamie Green. 7 snatches to that point of rep number 80. 6 seconds faster than Sam Briggs, who makes her way to the bar and has a little bit quicker of a transition.
I really like how fast Jamie Green, who's in the top part of your screen in lane 2, stepped up to the bar and started her first rep. Now we see another fail, and I might be the kiss of death when it comes to talking about her doing well and then missing a snatch, but take a step back. There's still plenty of time. Keep your pace. I know Briggs caught up a little bit. Toomey's breathing down your neck as well, but you only have the round of 5 left. Keep your head in the game. Stay calm.
2 reps remain in the round of 7 for Briggs in white and red. green and purple and gray on the top of the screen, and Toomey in yellow on the bottom of the screen. It's Green that gets to that point first by just 1.2 seconds over Briggs, 3.1 seconds over Tia Claire Toomey, and three of the biggest names coming into this year's competition are neck and neck going into the final round of 5 and 5.
Briggs had to break up her last two sets after going unbroken in the 13 and 11. She's going to break at three reps. Green as well. Tia's on the rings. Green might try to go all the way through it.
She does go five unbroken muscle-ups. Can she hold off two of the best CrossFitters the past couple of years? Sam Briggs, Tia Claire Toomey, trying to close the gap. It's a no rep for Briggs. Toomey will move into second, but she's got to make up two more reps over Jamie Green, who might be in position to take her first career event win. She was the open winner in 2016. The question was, what would she do as an individual? This year we find out, and she is your event three winner. Tia Claire Toomey, second place in the heat, second place in the event, in under the 9 minute mark. Sam Briggs with a couple of reps remaining, and her pace is starting to fall behind just a bit. It won't hurt her too much, but she will be beaten by Emily Bridgers this heat two time.
The thing with Briggs is that she's so good at muscle-ups, and sometimes when you're so good at something, it can trick you out of how you break things up. I think going unbroken in those first two rounds hurt her bad at the end of this event.
Sam Briggs will take an unofficial fifth place finish in the event. She'll start her competition with three consecutive top fives. It's going to be tight between her and Tia Claire Toomey for the points lead coming out of day number one. Christy Aramo quietly in the fourth position here in this one. Just chipping away through these reps in typical Christy Aramo fashion. She'll be fourth place in the heat, in under the 10-minute mark, and that'll be a solid finish for her. Looks like eighth place in the event.
Ah, she's very proficient in both of those type of movements. She doesn't really have that many holes in her game, so Christy Aramo has a very good and consistent day number one.
One rep differential between Sarah Sigmund's daughter, the two-time third place finisher on the right, Tennille Reed-Berline on the left in her second games appearance. Sigmund's daughter going for touch and go for five reps to close out this position. It'll be good for fifth place in the heat. And Sigmund's daughter recently moved to the States, Cookeville, Tennessee, originally from Iceland, will be fifth place in the heat, 12th place unofficially in the event. Tennille Reed-Berline, recently married a couple of months ago, sixth place in the heat, 14th in the event.
I think Tennille's just another one of those consistent athletes, a lot like Christy Aramo, is that she's just an athlete. You know, she's good at a lot of different things.
Kristen Holta, your event two winner. This is a solid finish for her in this one. She's in the seventh position, a few reps ahead of Katrin David's daughter. And seventh in the heat for Holta. Will be good for 20th in the event. And this is one of those damage control ones for her, known more for her endurance as opposed to high rep gymnastics. And this is an interesting story at this point with Holta in 20th. Means it's a back half of the field finish for your defending two-time champ, Katrin David's daughter.
And I think with the combination of these two, I probably would have pictured her doing a little bit better in this particular event, but you know, with the higher volume on the ring muscle-ups, not her strongest movement.
It's not out of the question that going into day number two, we may see the two-time champ outside of the top 10 going into the second day of competition, which means she won't be in the final heat for anything involving this format.
But it is a very, it's only day one. We have a lot of competition left to go. And if anyone can bounce back from that, especially on the women's side, Katrin David's daughter can do it.
Next finisher will either be Bethany Branham or Anna Tobias. This is Branham in lane number one. They're on opposite ends of the floor in lanes 1 and 10 respectively. Branham in her rookie appearance out of Hutto, Texas. She has one muscle up remaining. Tobias with two muscle ups remaining. There's the fifth and final one in the last round for Branham. Just 23 years old, made it to the games in her first try at regional competition. And Bethany Branham, ninth place here in the heat. And that leaves Anna Tobias as the final athlete left on the floor. 10th place in the point standings in the events that she's more well known for. You throw in those endurance type things, that's right in her, that's a pitch right over the plate for her. This one, not as much. She tries to hang on to go touch and go for the final five. She will do so, and Anna Tobias jumps up onto the platform under the 14-minute mark. And everybody here in heat number four will beat our 15-minute time cap, led by your heat winner and event winner for her first career event win in just her third event, Jamie Green. Not a bad way to make a debut here on this one, as Green does take this by 7 seconds over the two-time second-place finisher at the games, Tia Claire Toomey, who is second place. Emily Bridgers from heat number two will hold on to third. Alethea Boone all the way back in heat number one, the last-place athlete in the point standings, in fourth.
Started fast and furious for Sam Briggs, who's, like I said, she has muscle-ups for days, but I think it was one of those where what you were really good at ended up kind of hurting you towards the end, because I almost think she would have been much better breaking the muscle-ups early to make them even easier so that she would break less towards the end. And what happened is she started to break, and then it was Jamie Green on the top left part of the screen who went unbroken on the round of five, was able to hold on towards the end of the finish. And when she started off quick, I thought she was going to fall off the pace in the round of 11. She didn't. She bounced back and got her first event win at the CrossFit Games.
Jamie, congratulations on your first ever event win here at the CrossFit Games. How did you plan to break up these repetitions?
My coach said just to go off feel. And obviously you get out there and the adrenaline helps and you always get a few more reps than you think you're going to get. So my theory was just get up on the rings as fast as I could and hang on as long.
You were chasing down a Games veteran, Sam Briggs, for a lot of that event. How does that affect you mentally when you're out there?
I feel like I'm always doing it. She's always in front. But I just didn't look up and just tried to focus on what I was doing and just try to get that done.
You have competed on team before and on a very competitive team. How is this individual competition different for you?
It's very different. You feel a bit lonely sometimes at times because you just worry about what everyone else is doing. It's different. It's a lot of fun being individual, but I do miss my teammates. But I'll see them when I get back at home.
Jamie, thanks.
Thank you.
Jamie Green in her third career event gets her first career event win. And how about this? She sees herself in third place after the opening day of competition, a tie atop the leaderboard by a tie break. Give that position atop the point standings to Tia Claire Toomey, Sam Briggs in second, then Green, Christy Aramo, and Tennille Reed Berline rounding out the top five. Your two-time defending champ, Katrin Davidsdottir, in eighth. That does it for day number one of women's action at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. The familiar faces are out in front, but we're seeing that youth movement make its way into the top of the leaderboard as well. As we move to day two tomorrow, it should be a continuation of an exciting weekend of action. The men take on Amanda 45 next. We'll have Heat 1 coming up in a moment. two events down, one event remains for the men at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games on the opening day of competition. And it's here right now at the Alliant Energy Center, Amanda 45. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Sam Farber with you here in Madison, Wisconsin. The first ever event at the Games at the StubHub Center was Amanda. We step it up a little bit as the sport evolves, so does this event.
Yeah, we'll double Amanda, plus a little extra. It was 21 to begin with. It's 45 total reps of ring muscle ups and squat snatches at 135 pounds.
So this event has some history when it comes to the Games. For more on the event, we go to Sam Farber.
That's one of the great things about the way Dave Castro programs the CrossFit Games. You go back to 2010, the first time the Games were in Carson, Amanda was the first workout. Now, as we open up a new venue in the history of the CrossFit Games, the Coliseum, the first event, once again, Amanda 45. Another note on that, we call it a test, because if you don't do your homework and study previous events, you're going to get burnt. We'll see who's done their homework this year.
And the first wave of athletes to take on this test is here in heat number one. And a couple of very, very surprising names in this one. A couple of crowd favorites as well. And in 38th place, lane number nine, Josh Bridges.
Here's what I want to see from Josh Bridges. I want to see like Stephen King carry. You just got pig's blood thrown on you. I want you to burn this mother down in this event. He does not want to be here. I want to see Josh Bridges annihilate everyone.
Stand by.
Away we go, starting with 13 muscle-ups. And when it comes to the muscle-ups, keep an eye on the man in lane number three in blue and black, Cody Anderson. There may not be anybody better in the men's field at this movement.
All right, we're back at the CrossFit Games after, I think, missing it for the last 2 years. This is a guy who went unbroken in the muscle-up biathlon in 2014, where it had 18, 15, and 12. Same number of reps, but there was nothing impeding in between except for penalty runs, which he didn't need to take. But I really, really love breaking there. That is exactly what you want to see from someone who's good. Look, if you're good, then make it easy. Make it even easier and take yourself a break.
And he did that key number one with breaking up the sets early. Now you get a chance to lift with the legs on the second movement of this round of 13. These snatches at 135 pounds. As we watch Josh Bridges on the near side of the screen, keep an eye on the top of the screen. As that name in blue is Zeke Grove, he's through 18 of the 90 reps in this event. The leader's name will always be highlighted in blue, which is now Cody Anderson. Everybody else will be in red, with that number indicating how many reps they are behind. So Zeke Grove was the first athlete through the muscle-ups at a very quick split of 40.5 seconds, right in line with Josh Bridges. But Anderson, the smallest athlete in the field, is out in front, and he's made his passes on the barbell.
What Cody is very good at is it's gymnastics and it's being technical. So when you throw in 45 ring muscle-ups, of which if he wanted to do unbroken, he could. But he's going to break, and it's going to make these even easier for him because he's taking rest when he doesn't even need it. And then you throw in a high-skill move like a squat snatch at 135, which isn't a heavy weight, but there's 45 total reps. And Cody Anderson, who is so meticulous in his movement and his reps and his rescue, this is a great event for him to utilize that skill set to maximize his finishing place in this event.
Anderson leads by three reps, now two reps over the man on the left side of the center of the screen with no shirt, blue shorts. That's Travis Williams in the second position. And one of the larger athletes in the field is in second here on a muscle-up heavy event.
Well, second after the first round of 13, I would say Travis Williams is almost on the flip side of Cody Anderson, is that that guy will go through a brick wall to start an event if you told him to. The problem with that is that it doesn't lend to being very proficient towards the end of the event.
Anderson leads Bridges now in second place, the two smallest athletes in the heat. are out in front. Bridges at 173 pounds. Anderson at 172 pounds. Moving this 135 pound barbell efficiently well, especially when you look at Cody Anderson, smallest athlete here in the heat, but he might have the most pound for pound strength of anybody in this one.
Now, what he did start off is he started doing a few touch and go reps at the very beginning, and he looked very, I would say, unsure of himself with those high reps stringing them together. I like knocking it back down to singles. Him and Cody Anderson, Cody's on the left, Bridges is on the right, is that they are taking a little bit more time than I would have thought they would in between reps. Now, Cody did the same thing earlier where he was doing a few touch and go reps himself. We saw Jamie Green do it. She bounced back, opting for singles to the 9.75. I want to see how Cody and Josh does moving forward after this set of 11.
Anderson threw 48 reps. That is the round of 11. He's on to the round of 9, working towards rep number 66 of 90. Travis Williams back into the second place position when it comes to the snatches. That not a surprise. One of the few athletes I've ever heard of to have a sub 1 minute Isabel time, which is 30 snatches for time at this weight of 135.
And what Travis can do very well is move a barbell fast. And just no matter how tired he gets, he's still, I mean, it's the way he trains, right? He can train under fatigue, move bars well. What he needs to do is to be smart on the ring so he can maximize his strength, and that's on the barbell.
So your top three here on the screen on the left side of the split is Cody Anderson in blue and black. On the right side of the split in blue and black is Bridges, and with no shirt is Travis Williams. Anderson off the rings and back to that 135-pound bar for 9 snatches.
I'm just watching Josh on the side, and just something doesn't look right about Josh Bridges right now. He didn't fare well in the first event like he thought he would, the run, swim, run. Looked even worse on the bike, finishing towards the end. And I'm watching his muscles. This guy is one of the best in the game at him, and it looks like he's just trying as hard as he can to get on top of the rings. That is not a clean move for Josh Bridges. So he looks very off at this moment.
The oldest man in the field at 34 years old also has the second most event wins of any man in games history at 8, only behind Rich Froning. Trying to chase down Cody Anderson, who's 7 reps ahead of Bridges, and that is the final rep of round number 3. He's on to round 4, which is 7 muscle ups and 7 snatches.
I know 7's not a lot of muscle ups for Cody Anderson, especially with how good he is at these rings, but if I was him, I would break up this set for the final time. Maybe go 4-3 and move faster on the barbell. He's wasting a lot of time in between reps on the bar.
Bridges on the right side of the split has lost his second position, not to Travis Williams, who's one lane over from him, but in the background on the left side of the split with no shirt and the bright yellow shorts, that is Zeke Grove out of Australia. He's moved into the second position, 6 reps behind your heat leader, Cody Anderson. It's a good look at Zeke, 2-time games qualifier. And this not an unexpected good event for him. He does have in his repertoire 30 consecutive unbroken muscle ups. Back to the bar for Anderson, 7 reps here at 135, working towards rep number 80 of the 90 of this total rep count in the event.
He's cutting down his time in between reps. He did break on the round of 7. He's not stepping back as much as he did on the round of 13, 11, and 9. So Cody Anderson doing what I was hoping he was going to do after that set of 9, moving into this round of 7.
Bridges and Williams on the right continuing to fade a bit. Bridges making a late charge here on the round. Looks like he was going unbroken on that set of 7 muscle ups, and he moves back into the second place position.
And what I want Cody to do is with 5 and 5, now's your opportunity to shine at what you're good at. Do 5 unbroken, try to hang on to the bar for the last set of 5. You gotta look out for Zeke Grove, who's just to the left, because Zeke, he can actually do 30 unbroken muscle-ups, at least that's what he's put on record. So that's one of those guys that you don't want to open up the door too much towards the end.
Anderson threw all 45 of the muscle-ups in this event. Five of the 45 snatches, all that remains. This is setting the time to beat here in heat number one in this 13-minute time cap, the third of three events on day one of competition.
Hang on to the bar. It's your last set of five.
Cody Anderson in his rookie year stole the show with his performance in the muscle-up biathlon. Throw some more muscle-ups this time around in his second appearance, and the magic is back for Cody Anderson. It might be heat one, but 8:29.1 will be a very tough time to beat.
I can't tell you the last time I saw... I've never seen Josh like this before in any event he's ever done. Hands on the knees, taking big breaks, looking unsure of himself on the rings. There's just something off for Josh right now.
And a long day one for Josh Bridges, who has never found himself in the position he is. 38th out of the 39 athletes in the point standings coming into this one. He loses the second position again in this heat to Zeke Grove, who goes for five unbroken snatches at 135, and successfully so. He'll take second place in the heat, and Josh Bridges might be caught by Jeff Patzer in the purple shirt in lane number five. Bridges having to go to singles on the barbell. Patzer going for five unbroken. And Patzer will take the position if he can leg out Bridges, and he does. Patzer in third, Bridges in fourth, less than a half second behind. And for somebody that's known for just going on a constant attack for every single position, you're right, Chase. This is very uncharacteristic what we're seeing from Bridges today.
All day, not just in this event. In swim, run, swim, I mean, he was a heavy favorite in that. Did not do well there. The guy's been on a bike before. He even said he likes that type of event. I'm almost concerned for Josh at this point.
One of the early leaders, you said he would run through a brick wall at the start of an event if you would let him. That might have happened here for Travis Williams, one of the more emotional athletes on the men's side. He will get fired up. Sometimes it burns him just a little bit, and that might have happened here in this one. Seventh place finish in the heat for Williams.
You know, but I think that's why you can be a fan of Travis Williams, because you know what you're going to get, and it's going to be messy, but it's going to be crazy. You know, it's like that bull in a china shop. I think that's the classic description for Travis Williams.
Mitchell Cinnamon on the near side of the screen, making his second straight trip to the games out of the Pacific Regional. And he'll jump up onto the platform at 11 minutes and 5 seconds. And that leaves Elijah Muhammad as the final athlete on the floor. And the music actually just cut out for some reason here in the arena. And the crowd reacting in kind, trying to help Elijah Muhammad out for these five final snatches. I guarantee you, this is not going to be a problem.
Honestly, I would cut the music off to watch his last five final snatches too.
If this is the energy the new home here in Madison is going to bring, I'm going to love it here. That was a great moment as the crowd getting behind Elijah Muhammad when the music cuts out as they help him across the finish line in ninth here in the heat. About 3 minutes behind the leading time set by Cody Anderson, 8 minutes, 29.1 seconds.
Bridges started off and it just never looked comfortable in the rings, especially when he moved to the snatches after this. Cody Anderson did a great job of breaking this up. One of the best in the field with ring muscle-ups, second to Zeke Grove to his left, but to break those up early, to keep those singles. And once we got to like the round of 9 and 11, I've never seen Josh Bridges struggle on the rings like this before and did not look crisp on the snatches as well. Cody Anderson hangs on for his last five reps. Welcome back to CrossFit Games. You got yourself a heat win, Cody Anderson.
All right, Cody. 2014, your games debut, you go through the muscle-up biathlon unbroken. So no surprise here that you were able to handle this. What did you have go through your mind when you heard Amanda was the event today?
You know, Amanda's a good workout for me. I actually just did it like, I think like a week and a half ago or something, so I kind of knew what my abilities were, but at the same time, this is more than twice the amount of reps, so I knew it would be different.
And there's still a barbell involved. You're one of the lightest athletes in the field. How did you tackle that element of this workout?
You know, I just tried to pace it. Like, I broke up my muscle ups in every set except the last one just because I knew grip was going to be a factor. So the snatches actually caught me off guard. The set of 13 was okay, and then I had to go to singles pretty fast after that. So just kind of rolling with the punches and doing what I could to stay moving.
Cody, thanks so much.
Thank you.
One of the fan favorites, Cody Anderson, leading the way after the first of four heats. His time of 8:29.1, very game, but we've got 30 athletes left to take on that time. Heat number two is next. Welcome back for heat number two of four in men's event number three to wrap up the opening day of competition at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games on the men's side of competition. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Sam Farber with you. The Alliant Energy Center in Madison, Wisconsin. It has been absolutely electric in here, and the crowd getting a good show in our third event, Amanda 45.
There you go. Basically got double Amanda plus a little extra, 45 reps of muscle-ups and squat snatches at 135. I'm hoping some of these guys take a little page out of the Anderson playbook in this heat.
And our next group of athletes to try to take that top time from Cody Anderson's Heat 1 performance include a couple of very, very good gymnasts, as well as in lane number three, the reigning rookie of the year, Patrick Vilner.
Yeah, taking third place at the games last year, just a few points ahead of Fikowski. Not starting off as well as he probably had hoped for with the, you know, there was a lot of, I would say, buildup, you know, blame it on Dave Castro saying that Vilner is someone who could win the games one day. So Vilner sitting in this second heat, this is an event that he could bump himself back up into pretty good contention after this first day.
Last year's Rookie of the Year, this year's perhaps best rookie in this event, Alec Smith, the brother of Ben Smith, making his debut at the games.
Great at muscle-ups, great at snatches, not great at high volume, a little bit longer workouts with this, some of these couplets. So I'm curious to see how he handles the load and can he stay calm and paced out at the very beginning of this.
Stand by.
90 reps here at the Alliant Energy Center in Madison, Wisconsin to close out day number one. It starts with 13 muscle-ups.
I think Cody Anderson was reading our screens in the previous heat. You want to break up the sets early, even if these are easy for you, even if you got 30 in a row. Break them up and keep them easy. When you move to the snatches, we're going from a grippy upper body pull to a snatch. When done incorrectly, it can also be a very grippy upper body pull. Use your legs, get under the bar, catch it clean in a nice lockout so you're not wasting that dip out by pressing out some of your lifts.
First through the 13 muscle-ups, it won't be Alex Smith, it'll be Logan Collins in the center of the screen with no shirt and those blue shorts, the South Regional champion leading the way. His name highlighted in blue as the leader. Everybody else will be highlighted in red. The number will either show the rep count, which means they're tied for the lead, or a minus number indicating how many reps they are behind.
And I'm not surprised to see Collins get off the rings first. I know in the South, he wanted to do that 21-15-9 ring muscle-up and dumbbell overhead squat couplet unbroken, just ended up missing it because he had got a no rep in the very first round. So this guy is fully capable of handling the load it's on the rings. But again, like we saw with Sam Briggs, is that just being good at this isn't enough because these squat snatches get real hard really quick.
Collins was the first through the muscle-ups, less than a second faster than Alex Smith. For more on Alex, we go to Sam Farber.
Well, Alec is a rookie here, but obviously his brother is no stranger to the games. Ben Smith will compete in the final heat of the night. He's also the only male competitor who was around the last time Amanda was in the games in 2010. I asked him what he recalled about it. He says he remembered it being very difficult, very different. He also said it's a great way to gauge how far the athletes in the CrossFit games have come because they are way better since it's double the work here tonight.
So Alec making his debut appearance at the games, his brother, the most experienced male athlete in terms of individual competition in games history, not far behind him in terms of experience is your new event leader or heat leader, Scott Panchik in lane number two, blue shirt, yellow shorts, center of the screen.
Hey, breaking it up, he did six to start the round of 11. And you'll see a lot of guys do this. Round of 13, you'll probably see 7-6. Round of 11, 6-5. Round of 9, 5-4. Always that one break when you have such high, I would say, unbroken sets. All these guys are probably very close to 20-plus unbroken muscle-ups. Where I think he made up a lot of ground was on the snatches, is that his singles are very quick. This guy is used to this type of event at this level. Scott Panchik, super proficient when it comes to cycling bars, even if it's quick singles.
Panchik back to the bar, two reps behind Logan Collins. And when it comes to the barbell, Scott Panchik won't have an issue here with the snatches. He has the second highest listed snatch PR of 310 pounds. So Panchik in second, Vellner in third. He's with no shirt, blue shorts on the left side of the screen, but the leader on the near side with the black shorts is Logan Collins, continuing to hold off Scott Panchik.
And Collins had a good performance on the rings in the set of 11. But look at him take a step back. That doesn't seem like much, and it seems like not a big deal to even mention it. But when you drop the bar, you take a step back, eventually you start taking another step back and a little bit half event further. Scott Panchik, who's over there in lane number two, takes no steps back. He stays over his bar. He puts his hands on the bar when it drops, and that's where he's going to make that extra half second. Well, now he's done right there, but I really like Scott's just forcing himself to stay on the bar, saving yourself. Again, a half a second saved for 45 total reps can mean the difference between first and seventh. That's about 20, 25 seconds.
Scott Panchik leading the way. He is on the left side of the screen. Logan Collins in second. And this is a really just a bizarre position to see Scott Panchik in terms of the point standings. In the last 5 years, he's only finished worse than 20th 10 times. This year in the first two events, 20th and 31st.
I mean, we've been saying that all day, and not just for the men, for the women as well. I mean, you just had Josh Bridges in the first heat sitting in 38th place overall. Vellner's in this heat too. So I don't know what it was about this morning's event, but I do not think these guys were ready for that type of back-to-back.
Collins back out in front on the muscle-ups. He has been quicker than Panchik by a good margin on that movement.
And Panchik is actually breaking a lot more on the rings than Vellner and Collins are. And he's starting to run out of reps on the squat snatches. He's pretty quick on the singles. He's quicker than Collins and Vellner. But now when you move from 9.75, that advantage goes away after the 13 and 11.
The attention will no longer go to Panchik. You might as well move it to Patrick Vellner. He's on the left side of the screen, one rep behind Logan Collins. Make it really only about a half rep behind, as Collins with three snatches remaining, Vellner now with three snatches remaining in round number 3 of 5.
I said earlier how Panchik is gonna lose his advantage with the volume of squat snatches. Logan Collins is gonna lose his advantage with the volume left on the ring muscle-ups, especially to Patrick Vellner, who's on the left side of your screen. So if Vellner can keep it close enough to Collins going in the end, it's gonna be a very tight race once we get to the 7 and the 5.
4 seconds, the differential between Logan Collins in first on the right side of the screen, Patrick Vellner on the left, Scott Panchik still hanging around in that third position, not far behind. And with a quick transition like that, Panchik will move back into second place, only 2 reps behind Collins, as they start the round of 7 muscle-ups and 7 snatches.
Oh, it's good for Collins. He wasted very little time going up to the rings, and that comes with confidence in what you're good at, and it's ring muscle-ups as he just goes 7 unbroken on the right side.
3-rep lead to the barbell for Logan Collins out of Wiley, Texas. 26-year-old making his second games appearance. As for second place, 3 reps behind them, Scott Panchik has re-grabbed that position. Patrick Vellner right behind him, only 1.5 seconds back.
Collins has opened up a 4-rep lead on Vellner and Panchik. So if Collins can get through these, once he gets to the rings, those last 5 aren't going to trip him up. So Collins has set himself really well going into finishing up this set of 7.
In round 1, 2, 3, and 4, Collins has the fastest split on muscle-ups in this lead 3 battle, which could go a long way as he makes his way to the round of 5 and 5, the final round of this event. Keep in mind that time to beat on the left side of the screen, 8 minutes, 29.1 seconds, held by Cody Anderson, 1 heat to go. We thought that'd be a very tough time to beat. Collins has a shot at it. Unbroken set of 5 for Collins. 1 year ago, his only top 20 finish was an 11th place in the handstand walk event. In the 15 events, he averaged a 24th place finish. But here in event number 3, Logan Collins looking to set the time to beat with 2 reps remaining. Final rep, not going touch and go. It might cost him against Cody Anderson. There's the drop, the sprint to the mat. Your new leader with 2 heats to go is Logan Collins.
Came very close down to Cody Anderson's time and heat 1. I would have loved to see those guys go side by side. Unfortunately for Cody, he was in heat 1, so Collins gets the edge by about 5 seconds.
Panchik and Vellner battling on the snatches, give the edge to Scott Panchik. He'll move back into that second position just ahead of Patrick Vellner. These will all be good for top 4 times in the event. It's the second fastest time in heat number 1 is 9 minutes and 28.6 seconds by Zeke Grove. Classic CrossFit Games event, classic CrossFit pose at the end of a workout. Fourth place, Rob Forte. And for those that, as we talk about the history of this event and the games a lot in this event, for those that study up on the history, Rob Forte was part of that 2011 rookie class that had Dan Bailey, Josh Bridges, Michelle LaTondra, big, big names in the sport. The last one to keep an active qualifying streak is this man, Rob Forte's 7th consecutive games appearance. Closing in on the 10-minute mark in this 13-minute time cap event, Garrett Fisher is 3 reps ahead of Samuel Quant. Fisher in the gray and blue, Quant in the blue tank top.
I'm not surprised to see Garrett Fisher in this spot, but I am a little surprised to see Samuel Quant, just because the guy can cycle a barbell almost better than everybody here after winning double DT last year at the CrossFit Games, and that involved hundreds of cycling reps. But you know, it seemed to be that maybe the rings and this is a nasty combo. People love this event, but these two movements can really blow each other up if you misdose it inappropriately.
Going from one young athlete, 21-year-old Samuel Quant, to 24-year-old Alex Smith, one of the favorites in this one, didn't quite pan out that way. And you said he's good at both movements, just putting them together in the format could pose an issue. And it will be a 7th place finish in the heat for Alex Smith.
And that's the beauty of competition, because what you do on paper means nothing once you step onto the floor. And it's your ability to adapt on the fly, to change your rep schemes, to change everything if things don't go well in the beginning. And can you adjust and, you know, almost stick and move and try to get yourself out of that hole you dug yourself in early in this event.
Next finisher, Zach Carchetti. The 8th place in the heat, 15th here in the event with 2 heats remaining. 2 left on the floor. Holden Rethwill currently holding the 9th position. And this will be his final rep. He'll step onto the platform. And the only athlete to qualify out of the 6th position in a regional. A long story on that one, as he makes his way to the finish in 9th. And that leaves Tommy Vanas as the lone athlete on the floor with 5 reps remaining. Youngest athlete in the field, the 20-year-old Tommy Vanas out of Phoenix, Arizona. Put the finishing touches on his first experience at the Coliseum floor at the Games, stepping onto the platform for 12 minutes and 12 seconds. And that a good 3 minutes behind that man, your new heat winner, your new event leader with 2 heats left, Logan Collins, 8:25.03 seconds. So it's a 22-second win for Collins over Scott Panchik, Patrick Vellner, Rob Forte, and Garrett Fisher. Round out the top 5 here in heat number 2.
And it started off, Panchik was very quick on the single snatches, which put him ahead of Collins early. And he was doing well in the rings in the first part. And it was the snatches of Collins where he would kind of step back a little too long that opened the door for Panchik. But we didn't account for is that Collins was going to stay strong on the rings, not just through 13-11, but 9-7-5. He broke on the round of 9, but went unbroken the rest of the way. Vellner moved up ahead of Panchik once they got to the round of 9. Panchik struggled on the rings just a little bit, as Vellner still opting for those singles. But once they got through the 7, you know, switching orders is almost like a, you know, the game of cups they have on the street shows. But Collins moved himself back into first overall, went unbroken on the round of 5 muscle-ups, and that was enough time left for him to get that a heat win in this event.
Logan, 2 heats now we've seen here of Amanda, and both times it's some of the lighter guys in the competition coming away with the win. What's the advantage here in this event to being lighter than some of your competitors?
I think just the ability to hang on the rings a little bit longer. With the barbell snatches, it's like I didn't really think I could touch and go, so I just didn't even bother with it at the beginning. But I think it just boils down to keeping your hands on the rings as long as you can, and then fast transitions, which I've been working on a lot. So
it's your second trip to the Games right now. 2 heats still left to go, but you're in position to win an event for the first time. What would that mean to you in your CrossFit career to have an event win under your belt?
It's big. 100 points is huge. That's kind of all I'm worried about as far as winning the event, obviously, but it's a long weekend, and I know that. So I've learned a lot from last year, and I plan on taking that experience and applying it to this year and just going one event at a time. So it'd be nice, though. So.
Logan, thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
So a career best finish to this point was 11th place for Logan Collins. He currently sits in the number 1 provisional spot with 2 heats remaining. The next 10 athletes, heat number 3 coming up next. Welcome back to Madison, Wisconsin, as we're ready for heat 3 of 4 in men's event number 3 of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games at the Alliant Energy Center at our new home here in the Midwest. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Sam Farber with you as we've seen 20 athletes go through this one. Now we're going to see the next 10 take on this 5-round couplet.
Amanda, 45, 45 total reps, ring muscle-ups and squat snatches. With that 13 and 11, this is a completely different event than Amanda was.
A lot of young athletes in terms of games experience here in this one. A good 6 rookies in this, but what you're wanting to see is what we're having from a couple of the veterans, 4-time games athlete Noah Olson, most notably.
Well, some guy that can dance on the rings all day, and that is Noah Olson. He's also very proficient with a barbell. This is a guy who likes to start fast and push the pace for the other athletes in the field.
Another 4-time games veteran could be a factor, and that's Travis Mayer.
I don't know what it is about the name Travis, but this guy will also run through a brick wall, but he'll hang on as he runs through that brick wall. Travis Mayer will go out with Noah Olson. If both of them decide to start the pace early and fast, it'll be these two.
And we've seen it through the first 2 heats, but what you pointed out, it's been effective for both Collins and Anderson, your heat winners thus far.
Hey, if you're great at muscle-ups, stay great, but make them easy. Break up the muscle-ups early. Saving yourself 10 seconds in the first set is gonna pay dividends towards the end. And we saw Logan Collins do that in the beginning. When you get to the bar, use your legs. We're using that arms and upper body enough when we get to the rings.
10 seconds. Stand by.
6 rookies and 4 games veterans in the field here in heat number 3, trying to chase down the new top time of 8:25.03 seconds set by Logan Collins. And it starts here with 13 muscle-ups in the opening round.
We take our traditional Amanda that had 21 total reps of ring muscle-ups and squat snatches at 135 and adding 24 more. And Noah Olson, let me give you a little slow clap. Thank you for breaking him up. I wasn't sure if you were going to or not, but I'd like to see how that pays off for him once you move to the 9, 7, and 5.
And I got to be with you on that one. The question with Noah, he's always gone so hot early on in events, and it's normally come back to bite him just a little bit. This year, new coach, new mentality, and it looks like it's showing here in this early stages of this event.
Well, your new athlete, Dakota Rager, over there in lane number 2, went unbroken on the rings, and this is a guy who is, you know, for lack of a better term, a bodyweight freak. We saw that at the regional level. We've seen it on teams before. So Dakota Rager in the light blue and dark blue shirt, unbroken on the first set of rings. I like the singles on the snatches here, but what's gonna happen when we get to 11 and 9 moving forward? That grip is gonna be a factor towards this later part of this event.
Dakota Rager, one of 2 U.S. Army veterans in this heat alone. Both games rookies, George Sanchez being the other, Rager in 2nd. You see his name highlighted in red. The leader will be highlighted in blue. That currently Noah Olson, who's through 22 of the 26 reps in this opening round.
I like Olson's conservative start on the rings for the round of 13. Being a bit more aggressive on the bar, 2 to 3 touch and go reps. It works well if you keep your total rest less than what you would do for singles. You don't want to do 3 touch and go and end up resting more. It's not worth it.
Olson through round 1 in 1st, 3.7 seconds ahead of Street Horner. Dakota Rager in 3rd, just 4 seconds back. And how about the speed of the transition from the bar back to the rings for Olson?
Well, still, if you're looking at total time for this particular, it's not the fastest first round split we've seen. The fastest one is 1:33 set previously, and I think it came from Logan Collins, who was so fast going unbroken on the first set of 13. So 20 seconds off that fast first round pace. But again, I like the break as long as he can maintain the pace he's keeping on the squat snatches.
Dakota Rager in the dark blue and light blue combination now in the lead on the far left side of the screen. And he's through the muscle ups onto the set of 11 snatches in 1st, 3 reps ahead of Noah Olson, who's in the bright yellow shirt on the right split screen, and the purple shirt on back on the left side of that split is Street Horner, who's in that battle for 3rd.
I was trying to watch Dakota Rager, who's on the left side in the blue. His last rep, that lockout, he kind of did a little bit of a double pump where he locked out, wasn't clearly there, and had to press out yet one more time. That is a telltale sign that the muscle-ups are starting to go. The problem is that you still have 21 more reps left after this, so I want to see how Dakota handles the round of nine after he gets to these squat snatches. Noah Olson, who's sitting in the center lane in that yellow and blue top and bottom, he's still doing some touch and go reps, but look how long he's taking in between. We're at 10 seconds. Now we're moving to 15 seconds. For five total reps, it's not worth it. It's not worth the grip, and that's the big thing. He might not be more tired, but what touch and go snatches do to your grip will gravely affect your muscle-ups towards the end.
The additional rounds of this event, the 13 and the 11, are in the books. We get to the 9.75. That's the traditional part of this one. For a little extra on this event and the meaning behind it, we go to Sam Farber.
Well, Amanda is named after Amanda Miller. She was a competitor in the 2009 CrossFit Games and then sadly, less than a year later, passed away from melanoma. In her honor, Dave Castro made the first event of the 2010 CrossFit Games. Amanda, it's this event, or what's left of it now, this 9.75 portion of it, and now keeping her legacy alive and going back into the history books of the CrossFit Games in the new home out here in Madison.
Thank you, Sam. And the 9.75 underway for your top five athletes. Dakota Rager continuing to lead the way, five reps clear of Jason Smith, who's moved into the second position, one rep clear of Noah Olson in third.
Well, he did it again. I wasn't sure how it's going to go, but Rager went unbroken on the round of nine, and his pace on the snatches isn't bad either. We saw Collins take similar to the same amount of time in between reps. And what I want to see from Noah Olson is that, look, you're great at muscle-ups. He's on the right side of your screen. Stop doing touch-and-go reps on your snatches, because Rager, as of right now, doesn't look like he's going to break. Go to singles, stay with them, and then hang with them on the muscle-ups.
Two reps left in the round of nine for Dakota Rager. On the left side of the screen, Noah Olson has moved back into second place. Four reps behind Rager. Olson on the right side of the screen.
Just look how much time's ticking away. 12 seconds, 13, 14, 15 seconds in between breaks. That touch and go reps game, it's not gonna work. Not in this event. If this was 9.75, absolutely. Not here, it's too many reps. And with the volume of muscle-ups we have now, taking those big breaks are just costing him so much valuable time.
Olson's breaks have opened the window for Jason Smith and Paul Castillo in third and fourth. Here is Jason Smith. Mentioned it earlier today, six times top 10 in his region. This is the first time he's been able to qualify for the games, and he's representing a continent. He's the first Native African athlete to qualify for the CrossFit Games.
In this new regional format.
In this new qualification format, yes.
I'm looking at the clock, it's about 6:40, 6:45, and Rager's already into his set of seven. He's in lane two, top part of your screen, unbroken on the set of seven. He might be the first guy to go unbroken from start to finish. I mean, he's only got five reps left, consistent pace in these squat snatches. I really like Rager right now.
Rager, the smallest athlete in the entire men's field at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. He begins his final round. The 5'4", 169-pound Army veteran out of Lafayette, Colorado, leading the way here in the heat with a minute 10 seconds left until that time to beat set by Logan Collins in heat number two.
When this workout first got announced, he figured there's a lot of different ways that this event can be attacked. One of them was the ability to go unbroken on the rings if you have it and keep a nice, steady, consistent singles pace on the snatches. And I get your last rep. Oh, man, that would have been, I would have felt for the guy if he had to break up his last set 4-1.
It wasn't pretty, but it was effective. He goes unbroken all five rounds, back to the barbell. Why not go touch and go unbroken once again, this time with the barbell. Dakota Rager, the smallest athlete in the field, will have the biggest moment thus far here in event number three. He takes the new time to beat at 8 minutes, 1 second.
And that is the definition of playing to your strengths.
Second place, good race forming here between Noah Olson in the center of the screen and over in lane number one, Games rookie and Central Regional surprise champion, Paul Castillo.
He's just slowly creeping up on the outside, and that's sometimes the benefit of lane one is nobody really sees you coming.
Olson with a quicker transition, but struggling to get over the top of that last muscle up, but he does do so. And onto the barbell for the final time. How much of that pace early on with the barbell will he be affected by? Two down, three to go. Castillo, that's his first rep on the left side of the screen. That was the third, now fourth for Olson. Two rep differential between Olson at a Peak 360 CrossFit in Miami, Florida, and Castillo, and it will be Noah Olson. Second place here in the heat at 9:08. Paul Castillo out of Toledo, Ohio, will be our third finisher here in heat number three. Jason Smith, South African athlete in the fourth spot at 9:24. So the top four here in this heat will have top 10 times provisionally with one heat remaining. Street Horner, he was in the mix early on in that opening round of 13. Falls off a bit, but he's still holding on to the fifth position. Five reps ahead of anybody else. And Castillo was the Central Regional champion. He tied in points with that man, Street Horner, your fifth finisher here in heat number three. Sixth place is a race between Lucas Esslinger in the blue shirt, purple shorts, center of the screen, and Cole Sager with no shirt, blue shorts on the near side of the screen. It'll be Esslinger out of Switzerland taking the sixth spot. And the former University of Washington football player, Cole Sager, will be in seventh here in the heat. Next finisher, Travis Mayer. One of our favorites, bit of a surprise to see him in the eighth spot in the heat, 20th in the event thus far.
We had a lot of surprises today. Where these athletes have been finishing early in the morning, where they're sitting in these final heats tonight. I wasn't expecting that from Travis Mayer on this one.
Two explosive young athletes left on the floor. George Sanchez, U.S. Army veteran, served multiple tours in Iraq and Afghanistan. He will be the ninth finisher, and that leaves Jason Carroll with one rep remaining. And he'll drop the bar, run across that platform at 11:04 to round out the field of 10 here in heat number three. And for the third straight heat, we have a new time to beat. Now it's 8:01.56, 24 seconds faster than the prior time to beat. And it's Dakota Rager finding himself on the provisional lead. 25 seconds faster than the former time to beat, 1:07 faster than second place in the heat, Noah Olson. Paul Castillo, Jason Smith, and Street Horner round out the top five in a pretty interesting, despite the lack of passing for the lead, heat number three.
Well, I said in the beginning that I thought Dakota Rager's tempo and pace on the snatches was a little too slow based off the rest of the field. What I didn't account for is that he would be going unbroken the rest of the way. Noah Olson, who is going touch and go, but he was resting entirely too much in between. I think that was a poor game plan. If I'm sitting in the later heats, I'm watching that and going, I'm not gonna do that one. But Dakota Rager, what more can you say about this kid? Is this trying to get that final rep in the last round, almost barely unable to lock it out. Had gone unbroken 13-5, the first athlete to do so on both the men's and women's side. Took touch and go for the first time in his last set of snatches and took the heat win as well.
And Dakota Rager, the two-time team competitor at the games in the past, in his debut appearance, leading the way with one heat remaining. We'll have our top 10 athletes after the first two events take the floor next here in Madison. one heat remains on the opening day of competition at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games in an absolutely electric Alliant Energy Center here in Madison, Wisconsin. So we close it out with the men's side of competition in event number 3. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Sam Farber with you here in Wisconsin. And we've seen 3 heats. We've seen 3 top times come out of it, each one getting successively faster in this 45 rep couplet where we're splitting up the work on a classic games event.
Yeah, we're talking about Amanda. Traditionally, it's 975, ring muscle-ups and squat snatches at 135. Well, you know, it's the CrossFit Games, like Dave Castro says, so we're anteing up. We're going to add 13 and 11. That means 21 reps. We're bumping it up 24 more reps for 45 of each. And after we've had 7 heats go, I'm hoping someone can put together the perfect combination of rep schemes and speed and see if anybody can break an 8-minute barrier.
We saw very close to it, 8:01.56, the time from 1 heat to go set by Dakota Rager. We've got the top 10 athletes in the point standings here in this heat, and the current points leader, Janikowski. That's not an unfamiliar spot for him on the opening day of competition. He's been here before in games past. Matt Fraser, the defending champion, in second. Bjorkvin Carl Goodmanson, the 2015 games third place finisher, in third here thus far. As far as the layout here in this heat, we will see Koski in lane number 5. Matt Fraser will be in lane number 6. But a couple of athletes that you want to keep an eye on especially will be the 2015 champion in lane number 10, Ben Smith.
And not to mention, he got second last year to one of the most dominating performances we've ever seen at the CrossFit Games. So Ben Smith sitting in 10th, not a bad spot for him. Didn't have the best morning that he probably wanted to. Had a great run, swim, run, but I was surprised how much he struggled on the bike course. And when you put it in high volume muscle-ups and squat snatches, Ben Smith is a name you're gonna put at the top of the list next to Matt Fraser.
All 10 already through 7 reps. Nobody's dropped off the rings just yet. And as I say it, James Newberry and Frederick Agidius do so, but several athletes still going unbroken. And Matt Fraser is one of them. He will be the first man off the rings in the gray shirt, yellow shorts, all 13 unbroken in nearly 40 seconds flat.
Now, I usually say that that's a bad idea, but I will not say that when Matt Fraser does it. And when I've seen Fraser, I've seen him do regular Amanda at the fastest time that I have ever seen. The speed at which he attacked that event, unbroken muscle-ups and unbroken snatches. I don't think the ring muscle-ups are going to be a problem. And when you're talking as one of the best lifters in the field, 135-pound snatch, especially when he's deciding to do singles, is not going to be an issue. So for him, I believe the race is going to be on the rings like it was for Dakota Rager. The deal for Matt Fraser is he's a lot faster on the barbell.
Now the question is, Matt Fraser's pace, we're gonna trust him. He's proven he can handle a pace like that. The man on the left is your leader though. His name highlighted in blue, that's Alex Anderson. If Fraser is the strongest in Olympic lifting in the field, the strongest in terms of raw power in the field might be Anderson on the left.
It will be, but when you're talking about the ring muscle-ups, that'll probably pose to him a little bit of a problem. I'm not gonna say much, but I wouldn't peg Alex Anderson as someone that should continue the ring muscle-up pace like Fraser is. And you see on the left side, he takes a very conservative, very smart break, Alex Anderson.
Once again, leader's name will be highlighted in blue. Everybody else will be in red with a rep counter indicating how many reps they are behind the lead. The leader currently, Matt Fraser, the second place athlete in point standings after 2 events, and the defending 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games champion.
Well, I tell you what, I don't think he wants you to hear you say the second place overall after the first part of the morning, because I know he's sick and tired of that number. He took the monkey off his back last year. This guy has been a absolute force since the games podium that he stood on top of last year.
Fraser looking to be the first Triple Crown champion, if you want to give it a name, since 2014 when Rich Froning did it. Fraser won the Worldwide Open, he won his regional, and he's looking to be a two-time games champion here this year.
A little Ricky Garrard up there in between Alex Anderson and Matt Fraser. He's in no shirt, blue shorts. Absolutely demolished the cyclocross event for event number two. And this guy is not throwing in or pulling any punches when it comes to these top guys in the field. I really am enjoying Ricky Garrard's attitude and intensity that he's bringing to this event.
Narrowly missed out on qualifying 1 year ago, 2 points shy from one of those five qualifying spots out of the Pacific, making the most out of it this year now that he's gotten here, as he had that cyclocross win, as you said, in dominant fashion, about a minute faster than the rest of the field. And Garrard, 2 reps behind Fraser, who's on the right side of the split.
Fraser, that should be his final rep here in the set of 11, has gone unbroken in 13 and 11 as he moves into what would we consider grace, starting at 9, 7, and 5.
And if he did that with the shirt on, this is the traditional moment of business getting real. Matt Fraser with the shirt off now as he's onto the rings and already out in front on the round of 9 and 9. 2 reps ahead of Ricky Garrard in the blue shorts on the left side of the screen. Yannikowski has moved into the third position just ahead of Alex Anderson. And Koski, for being the points leader, we sure haven't mentioned his name a lot in this one as he sits in third.
Fraser broke for the first time at 5. Garrard has decided to try to push through.
As we watch Ben Smith putting in work here, he currently sits in the 8th position. For more on him, we go to Sam Farber. Sorry about that, a little bit of difficulty there in getting to Sam. We apologize for that, as Smith working in the 8th position here in the heat. But out in front, it continues to be Matt Fraser, but by a smaller margin than it's been to this point, as he's only about a half rep ahead of Ricky Garrard in second.
Which is surprising to see, because Garrard went all the way through the round of 9, whereas Fraser broke at 5.
That Garrard split, you're pointing that out on the muscle-ups, was 16 seconds quicker than Fraser in that third round, the round of 9. And it's a 1 rep difference, and Fraser basically staring a hole into Ricky Garrard at this point. It's only a couple of reps over to his right. Fraser to round number 4, just ahead of Garrard. The 3-time games podium finisher. 2 seconds and a first for Fraser, trying to hold off the games rookie, Ricky Garrard.
And he needs to hold off Yannikowski too. Koski sitting in first overall with almost 20 points between him and Fraser. He's just one spot back, and what Fraser needs to do is he just got a no rep there, and that's gonna be tough. He broke on the round of 9, 5, 4. That's gonna probably force him to break here in the round of 7.
He does break after 4. Also the case for Garrard, who breaks after rep number 4. They both leave 1 rep remaining less than they had on this opening set, with 3 reps left this time. Synchronized muscle-ups for Fraser and Garrard, separated by just 1 rep. Fraser drops down, makes his way to the bar. Just a couple of seconds ahead of Garrard in second. Koski and Goodmanson also on the charge in 3rd and 4th. Simultaneous muscle-ups. We now have simultaneous snatches. I'm not quite sure who Fraser was trying to direct away.
I know exactly what he was doing. I don't know who he was talking to, but he was talking in front of the person that's standing in front of the clock that's on the floor. Fraser knows what the time to beat is. He knows that he has to break 8 minutes if he wants to get an event win, one of which he only got one of last year at the first part of the games. So he knows how fast he needs to go to keep his pace here on the singles. He's had a rough time in the 9 and 7, getting a no rep in the round of 7. He's only got 40 seconds left to get there. He's watching Garrard, but he also needs to think about the times ahead of him.
8:01.56 seconds, the time of Dakota Rager in heat number 3. The second fastest time is 8:25.03 by Logan Collins in heat number 2. Fraser has his sights set on that time to beat, which is 20 seconds away. Locks out the muscle up. He comes down and breaks on the set. That means that he likely won't beat that time to beat. Ricky Garrard trying to do so, and he drops shy of that fifth muscle up. Fraser to the bar first, trying to hang on to the heat win. It won't be an event win. It could be good for second place, though. Three reps down, two remain for Fraser. Fraser breaks on the snatches on the final set of five. That opens the window for Garrard. Fraser back onto it. Garrard is going to go singles. Fraser will hold him off. He'll run to the platform. And Matt Fraser, second place in the event with the Heat 4 win. Ricky Garrard backing up his event 2 win in cyclocross with a solid finish here in event number 3. He comes in second in the heat, good for fifth in the event. So back-to-back top 5 for Garrard. Jonakowski entered this event 16 points ahead of Matt Fraser for the points lead. And likely will be giving up that spot to Fraser. Still will be a solid finish for Jona. He has one rep remaining on the snatch. He's trying to hold off BK Goodmanson just behind him. And Koski will do so. Points leader coming into this event will likely not have that points lead going into day number 2. So he takes 3rd in the heat and 9th in the event. Jorgvin Carl Goodmanson sticks the landing onto the platform. Good for 4th in the event and 11th in the event. Excuse me, 4th in the heat, 11th in the event.
I think this event has surprised a lot of athletes today. They knew it was going to be harder and longer, but I don't know if they thought it'd be this tough.
Nice sprint to the platform. Give the edge to Ben Smith at 934.66. About 84 hundredths faster than Brent Fikowski, who will be 6th in the heat. Lane number 1, that was Alex Anderson, your early round 1 leader. He'll be 7th in the heat. Frederick Agidius, next finisher. He'll be 8th in the heat. And 22nd in the event, unofficially right at the 10-minute mark. And that leaves a couple of young athletes. Cody Mooney on the near side of the screen making his rookie appearance out of Sanford, Maine. Just 23 years old, 26-year-old James Newberry, the only other athlete left. And Cody Mooney be our 9th finisher here in the final heat of the evening. 10 minutes, 29.81 seconds. And Australia's James Newberry back on the rings with 6 reps overall remaining. This is the last of the 5 muscle-ups in the final round. One of his teammates in terms of the training program that they both use, Brent Fikowski cheering him on. The final 5 snatches. Newberry has a lot of backing behind him this year. He's 24th 1 year ago. He's considered one of those sleeper picks for a podium spot this year. Found himself in 7th place coming into this event. He'll slide from that spot as he rings up the rear of the field in 10th at 11:14. So looks like it'll be good for a 36th place finish in the event. And Matt, hate to do it to you, it was a heat win, but once again, second place, as he did several times in his dominant performance 1 year ago. But it's a second place event finish for him. Dakota Rager, the rookie out of the South Regional, will hold on to the event win at 8 minutes, 1.56 seconds. But here in heat number 4, it's our second place finisher, Matt Fraser, that really put on a show in this one.
And it was very quick singles from the start, but it was the unbroken set that he did through 13 and 11. And I think it's just one of those is that you always, it's easy to second guess after the event's over, but I think maybe breaking once in the first 2 rounds could have saved him a break or 2 towards the end. He had that no rep in the round of 7 that hurt him out, and he's looking at the clock, and that's exactly what was happening when he was waving a cameraman out of the way of the floor clock so he could see where he was at. Ended up having to go 4-1 on the last set of 5 muscle-ups, but hung on towards the end there. Matt Fraser got himself a heat win.
Matt, another outstanding performance for you. You're the defending champion, obviously, of the games. How much harder do you feel your fellow competitors are coming after you right now?
Oh, I mean, the whole list. I mean, guys from heat 1 to 4, you know, they're putting up good times to chase. So, you know, you're not just racing against the guys in your heat. It's very competitive.
It's our first time here in Madison, Wisconsin. You've experienced so much in your CrossFit career, but tell me how this atmosphere here compares in this new venue to what you've experienced in the past.
You know, I think the number one concern for every competitor was the night events. We were going to miss the magic of the tennis stadium under the lights, but we're not missing anything here. We still got it.
Matt, one more for you. A similar position to where you were last year in the competition. How do you feel about the way it's shaping up for you after one day?
You know, I don't have any feelings about how it is after one day. You know, it's a 4-day competition. You know, the events that were announced, you know, I like them all. It's going to be a good test.
Matt, thanks so much.
Yeah, thank you.
So Matt Fraser with the second place event finish here, the Heat 4 winner. That win goes to Dakota Rager overall in the event. But the big win after day number one does go to that man, the defending CrossFit Games champion, Matt Fraser, as he will find himself atop the points leaderboard after the first three events of the competition. Good at 260 points. Janikowski will fall from first only down to second place. And Ricky Garrard has been the young bright spot in this competition. He sits in third.
If you would have asked me what the top three was going to look like after the first day, I would have lost all the money that I bet on it. Look at some of these names in the top 10. Cody Mooney, Dakota Rager, Jason Smith. I mean, Ricky Garrard is in third place. This is amazing to see, and I hope it continues to the next 3 days, because this is what the games needed. We didn't need another runaway type win, especially from Matt Fraser or anyone else prior to that, Rich Froning. We want there to be just an atomic bomb put on the leaderboard. We're getting it so far.
Oh, by the way, this was only day one, and we see a top 10 that I don't think anybody predicted in the Pick'em contest over on the Games website. After day one, Matt Fraser is in first, but it's an absolute wild card. In the rest of the top 10, we still have 3 days remaining with day two coverage coming up bright and early in the morning tomorrow. We'll see you then.
And see what they're doing and try and idolize and model that to try and keep up. So, but yeah, I'll keep putting in the work and